We have some reasons to be positive, but I will try to prove it. Yes. So, with that in mind, let's begin with purchasing manager index, as it reflects the opinion from manager from industry and services companies. What we can say when we see that? Firstly, the positive impact dynamic remain unabated, especially in the US. As you can see, it's very high. It's in dark blue. That's why the GDP growth is expected to be high in the US, as you can know it, in 2018 and for years to come also. But in Europe, in the UK, in the euro area, and in the main countries like Germany, France, Italy, and Spain, the situation could be a bit different. As you can see, from mid-2018 onwards, we see a decrease, a slowdown in these surveys. It's a synchronized slowdown. For example, in the UK, it's relatively low, hein, in light blue, low, but still over the 50 basis. That's why we will be still in positive growth in the UK, and this is good news given the current context. We have a slowdown in the euro area. As you can see, it's recorded, it's in line since mid-2017, explained by main countries like Germany, France, Italy, and Spain. We can see in orange France. France is above in terms of line than Germany, Italy, and Spain, because we expect a rebound in terms of GDP growth for the second half 2018 compared to the first half 2018. But with that in mind, let's have a look at the employment growth expected in Europe, in most countries in Europe for 2018 and, of course, for 2019. What can we say? Firstly, yes, we are expecting a decrease in terms of growth, but not a decrease in terms of employment. It's a slowdown in terms of growth in 2019 for most countries like Portugal, Spain, Ireland, Netherlands, and so on. But we reach a peak, a high peak, in terms of employment dynamic in those countries. In Italy, we expect a not too bad growth in 2019 because we didn't have a strong increase in terms of employment growth in last years, like 2017 and 2018. But let's come back to Germany and France. We don't expect a significant drop in terms of employment, especially in France. 0.9% expected in terms of employment growth is more or less the same growth expected this year in 2018. And still a 1% growth in Germany for employment is not too bad. The non-positive news in the UK, after an increase, moderate increase, but anyway, an increase in terms of employment growth in the UK, 0.4% in 2018, after 1.4% in 2017, we expect a leveling off in terms of employment in the UK for next year. But it's, of course, the employment growth for the whole country, employment by employment and GDP growth. If you can see this slide, it's the employment in Europe broken down by departments. And what can we say? In the legend, it's easy to read. The darker the green, the stronger the employment growth. For example, in Germany. In Germany, we know that we don't expect a positive trend in terms of employment and in demography for years to come. For the next decade, we expect a lower population in this country, and it's an easy forecast. It's very structural in terms of forecast. But in some major cities like Berlin, Frankfurt, Hamburg, or Munich, we still expect strong increase in terms of employment, in terms of demography for years to come. We expect a catch-up effect in terms of employment growth after not too important increase expected in the last three years. This is the main point we can have. And for France, we can speak a bit for France today. We don't expect a strong growth for years to come compared to the 2.3% GDP growth recorded in 2017. But in Paris, in Lyon, in the south of France, on the west of France, we will have outperformance in terms of growth, in terms of employment dynamic compared to the whole country. It's the same in Italy, hein, between the north in Italy and the south in Italy. That's why even if we have a low GDP growth in Italy, close to 1%, it's a structural GDP growth in Italy, we will have a positive impact, good news, for example, in Milan and Roma. So now let's have a look at the office take-up in Europe with a historical series since 2001. We can begin with Germany Big Four. Germany Big Four includes Berlin, Munich, Frankfurt, and Hamburg compared to Île-de-France, the whole Île-de-France. As you can see, between 2001 and 2015, the office take-up for Germany Big Four and Île-de-France was more or less in line. It was more or less the same key figure up to 2015. We have a break in 2015, mainly explained by Berlin. Berlin has known a very catch-up effect, a strong increase in terms of take-up, plus 65% in terms of office take-up, compared to the average 2006, 2007, 2008, with the average 2016, 2017, and 2018, compared to only plus 10, plus 15% in Hamburg, Frankfurt, and Munich. That's why it's mainly explained by Berlin, the catch-up and the strong difference in favor of Germany compared to Île-de-France. This is the first point. Central London, the situation is not too bad so far. Yes, we see a strong drop in 2016 because of the Brexit vote, as you know. Leveling off in terms of take-up in 2017, thanks to a drop, a correction in terms of rents, in headline rents and in incentives as well. And from now on, we see a rebound in terms of take-up for 2018, despite the economic and geopolitical context, as you know. In Île-de-France, a good situation, 2.6 million square meters expected in terms of office take-up, more or less the same key figure recorded in 2017, especially thanks to large offices letting in 2018. So now let's have a look at office vacancy rates in Europe. It's the office vacancy rate, not only for the city itself, but the city plus the periphery. And I think it's crucial to underline this, especially for Berlin. Berlin, only a 2% vacancy rate. It's not only Berlin itself, it's Berlin plus the periphery. It's the same for Cologne, Munich, and so on, with vacancy rate below 3 or 2%. In Paris, the situation is not too bad, hein? 5.5% in terms of vacancy rate. For Île-de-France, on the whole, because in Paris itself, it's a lower, much lower vacancy rate, and we will have a slide just after in order to explain more in details this situation. In Southern Europe, we see more or less a double-digit vacancy rate, between 9 and 10% in Madrid and Barcelona, Milan 11%, Roma 8%, but if you have a look at the CBD in Madrid and Milan and so on, the situation is much lower in terms of vacancy. It's difficult to find new buildings with a very well location, as you can guess it. In London, it's a stabilization, even a decrease in terms of vacancy rate, but the situation shouldn't last for the future, and we will see our forecast in terms of vacancy rate for 2019. We expect a decrease in the whole market in Europe in 2019, expect in Germany. So, yeah, now let's have a look more in details for office vacancy rate for offices in Île-de-France, broken down by some markets in Île-de-France. How can we read this? For example, we have the new buildings in terms of vacancy rate. It's dark blue. In light blue, the second-hand vacancy rate, and we can compare it by the average 2008-2019 in order to see the balance key rate for each market, because the balance point is not the same between markets. The average, the balance point in terms of vacancy rate for Paris, it's close to 4% and 5% compared to 8% and more for the periphery like La Défense. For Paris itself, the situation is very in undersupply. Paris inner city is recording 2.4% only in terms of vacancy rate. It's a low point historically since 2001, only 1.6% in terms of vacancy rate in Paris CBD, and the situation is in undersupply in every suburb in Paris itself. A low point, very low vacancy, is recording in La Défense, 4.4% compared to 8% over the last decade. And finally, we can have only two subsectors in concern, especially Paris Défense. It's the city around La Défense and the northern river bend, where we can see a strong vacancy rate with high second-hand supply. And in other subsectors, the situation is balanced or in undersupply in La Défense as well, even if the situation couldn't last for the future. So, yes, now let's have a look at this. What we can have this, it's the supply, the total supply under construction and in non-prelet. Yes, it's all in all, we can have a supply under construction close to 1.2 million square meter. It's more or less at the top historically. It's significant, that's why we have to be careful for the buildings under construction for the future. But we can have positive news after saying that, especially the breakdown for the buildings under construction, the breakdowns with two dimensions. First dimension is the date of delivery. As you can see at the top right, it's the completion in 2018, 2020, and so on. We don't have many buildings at the same date. It's good news. We have it's relatively balanced in terms of completion for next year, for 2020, and so on. That's why we will have the time to consume these buildings for the future. That's why even if we expect a positive impact, an increase in terms of vacancy, the increase shouldn't be very very high. And we will have some forecast for that just after in the following slides. Even if we have the breakdown by date of completion and by suburb, in Paris inner city, La Défense, Inner Rim, Western Crescent, it's relatively balanced with 20-30% of buildings. We don't have every building, all buildings in the same location. It's a positive news in order to moderate the high level recorded currently in buildings under construction. So, but even if, as we expect, high buildings under construction for the future, incentives should remain relatively high for years to come. Here you can see incentives for offices in Île-de-France. All in all, for all offices for the whole Île-de-France region, we reached in 2018 22% in terms of incentives. You can see an increase in terms of incentives since 2015 from 20% to 22%, but we have a change in terms of sample. What can we say behind that? In 2015 and 2016, we have had more buildings in Paris itself. And since 2017, we have more buildings in the periphery. That's why the sample is not constant. That's why we have an increase in the average. So we can say, all in all, in order to simplify the speech, moderate a leveling off in terms of incentives close to 22% all in all. If you have the breakdown in terms of incentives by suburb, you can see some strong discrepancies, especially in Paris itself, with a low compared to the rest in terms of incentive, 16% in Paris CBD, 17% in Paris Left Bank, and so on, compared to high incentives, more than 20-25% in the Western Crescent and La Défense as well. Even if we currently are in undersupply in La Défense, we have still high incentives at 25%. This is the message we can have, and for the future, we expect not much lower incentives, eventually in Paris CBD with 15% expected for next year, but more or less a stabilization is expected in terms of incentives for the next 2 years. So now let's have a look, not for the underlying rent, but for headline rents for new offices. What are the news behind that? Firstly, a notable increase in each suburb is recorded in 2018. And we can say it's a news because it was a leveling off. It was a very moderate increase or change recorded since 2012. And we have an increase in Northern River Bend, Paris Défense, not in La Défense, but we don't have significant new buildings in transaction for 2018. This is the explanation. And in Paris CBD, Opéra and Étoile, the rise is relatively strong. In Paris CBD, since 2015, we have recorded 10%, 15% increase in terms of market rental rental values. This is the most important, notable increase we recorded in Île-de-France. So, for the future, we expect a more moderate increase in terms of rates, but still an increase for most markets for the future. So now let's have a look for our forecast for 2019, not for average rent, not for new offices, but for prime rents in Europe for most markets, as you can see. Let's come back to German markets, for example, Berlin or Munich, and you can see historically the strong increase observed in Berlin. Here you have an index 2008 equals to 100, and Berlin's has recorded 80% increase between 2008 and 2018, and we expect still 10% growth in terms of rents for next year, compared to more or less a double-digit growth this year and last year. This is the first point. London, stabilization, a leveling off in terms of prime rents for next year compared to 2018, but we still recorded a decrease in terms of rents, minus 15, minus 20% in terms of headline rents in London from 2015 to 2017. And beyond that, we also recorded an increase in terms of incentives. Incentives have more or less doubled in London, for example, from 13 to 23% for the city, and so on. And for West End, it's more or less the same increase we still have. So in Paris, we can say for prime rents, it's relatively moderate historically. At 850 euros, this is the same key figure recorded in 2007 and 2008. That's why we can hope a positive impact, an increase in terms of rents for Paris CBD and major markets in Île-de-France for the future, but not a strong increase, a moderate increase for year to come, maybe a bit higher than inflation expected between 1.5-2% for the future. Now, yes, I suggest we can have a look and come back to the economic context with one of the main concerns, potential external shock we can have in the real estate market in Paris, but in all countries in Europe and in the world as well, it's the 10-year government bond yields. What can we say for 10-year government bond yields in 2018? We don't see any significant change for government bonds in most markets in Europe. A leveling off in Germany, France, the UK. The main concern, the main increase we record, and it's in peak, it's Italy. 2% in terms of 10-year government bond yields in Italy in May. Now we reach 3.5%, 3.6% for the 10-year government bond yields in Italy. And you know the reason, it's of course the challenging geopolitical context. But thanks to this increase in terms of government bond yields in Italy, we don't have an increase in government bond yield in France and in Germany. We have had a safe haven attitude for Germany, for France, and if you see the chart more in details, if we have had an increase in the yields, the government bond yields in Italy, meanwhile, we recorded a decrease for the 10-year government bond yield in France and in Germany, and this is one of the main reasons we are still at 0.7% for the 10-year government bond yield in France and 0.4% in Germany. This is the spot in terms of 10-year government bond yields. But now we can see the future, and it's not only the BNP Paribas forecast, it's the consensus economics done from October 2018, what main forecasters can expect in terms of potential increase for government bond yields for the future. In 2019, we don't expect a significant increase in terms of 10-year government bond yields. As you can see in Germany, we expect at end 2019 0.8% compared to only 0.5-0.6% at end 2019. It's more or less the same story we have in France with a delay. In 2019, 1.3% expected compared to 0.9% expected. Even if we expect we will have an end of quantitative easing at end 2019, we will have more factors, more or less four factors, which impact negatively government bond yields for the future. Firstly, we will have a more risky geopolitical context, especially with protectionism. This is the first point. Second and third point, we will have lower growth in terms of GDP, in terms of employment and inflation, and all of this justify a lower 10-year government bond compared to the future. And last but not least, we will have a high liquidity for the next decade compared to the past, and this justifies a lower 10-year government bond yield compared to the past. That's why, even if we expect an increase in terms of 10-year government bond yields, we expect a moderate, a gradual increase in 2019 and 2020. But once we have said that, the question is what is the impact in property yields for the future? And this will be not this slide, but the next slide. In here, you can have the spot office prime yields in Europe in order to see the current situation. Most markets are below 4% in pink, especially in Paris, London, in German markets. And it's a bit news. It's not the same compared to the story. In terms of ranking, it's relatively new to see Berlin lower than Paris, lower than London. It's a bit the inverse situation compared to the past. But it's not crazy to have a lower office prime yields in Berlin currently, vis-à-vis the lower 10-year government bond in Germany. This is the first point. And if we have a strong expectation in terms of rental values for the future in Berlin, it's not crazy to accept a lower office prime yields compared to Paris at 3% or London at 3.5%. All in all, we have had a decrease in terms of office prime yields in Europe. It's in blue, as you can see. The only leveling off, it's in London or in Madrid. Currently, the prime yields, as you know, it's at 3% in Paris and at 3.9% in Lyon. Here, well, it's not the most beautiful slide I can share with you, but maybe I will try to explain it. I will do all my best for that. Here, you can see a proposal, a sensitivity analysis. It's the property yields compared to bond yields for the French offices in Île-de-France and in regions. It's in order to answer the following question: what will be the threshold in terms of OAT, a 10-year government bond in France, from which we will see a positive impact, an increase for office prime yields? What could be the answer? In for office CIS in Paris CBD, below 1.75% in terms of 10-year government bond yields, we don't expect any increase for office prime yields in Paris CBD. It's between 1.75% and 2%, which should have an increase in office prime yields, as you can see it. This is the first point we can have, and as you can see, for offices in Île-de-France and region, the threshold is fairly close to 1.75% and 2%. How can we calculate this? I can guess the question. yes, yes. Firstly, we have in mind, and we can calculate the average risk premium recorded in the past. For Paris CBD, the average risk premium observed in the market, it's 150 basis points from 2003 up to 2013. I stop my calculation at 2013 because from 2014, the situation is not normal because this is the start of the quantitative easing. That's why, in average, 150 basis points is the risk premium, the yield gap between Paris office CBD and the 10-year government bond yield. It's the average spread for a normal, for an average situation. But currently, the situation is not normal. It's more positive than usual in terms of vacancy rate, in terms of rents, because rents are moderate. That's why we can have a positive impact on that. That's why it's not crazy to expect normally a lower risk premium currently, close to, for example, 120 basis points, 130 bips. And this is the risk premium, the yield gap we expect and we add at the 10-year government bond yield for Paris CBD. For other markets, for example, in Paris outside CBD, we calculate an average risk premium between Paris outside CBD and Paris CBD for the future, and we add this to the yield expected in Paris CBD, and we do the same for each market, and we, with that in mind, we can have such a table. So this is our calculation and our result for offices, and this is more or less the same representation, but in line. At the top left, you can see again the threshold for offices. How can we read this? It's from which 10-year government bond yields, we can see an increase for office prime yields. You can see again at the top left the threshold at 1.75% and 2%. In La Défense, the situation is a bit more more positive. If I could come back to La Défense, currently we have, we expect at end 2018 an office prime yield for La Défense at 3.9%. It's historically low, but it's historically high compared to the Western Crescent. Western Crescent, it's at 3.25%. It's very low. Very low compared to only 3% in Paris CBD. That's why, as soon as, and potentially, it's an expectation, we can have an increase in terms of 10-year government bond yields, the less impact, the lower impact will be for offices in Ile-de-France in La Défense, thanks to our explanation. So, now we can speak about other asset classes in France. At the top right, we can speak about retail. Retail, one of the main concerns, main challenging context, it's mainly for high street retail in Paris. The current prime yield, it's at 2.5%. It's relatively low, and that's why from a 10-year government bond yield at 1.5%, we could record a start in increase for the high street retail prime yield in Paris. But the situation is better. The gap between prime yields with shopping center and retail park and high street retail is currently relatively high, more than 100 basis points. It's relatively high compared to the past. That's why we could record an increase for office prime yields in retail, not as we will have 10-year government bond yield below 2.25%. Yes, we have a protection for retail park and shopping center. For logistics, as you can see, the threshold is expected between 1.75 and 2% for warehouses, but for industrial premises, the situation is better with a threshold expected at 2.25%. But I can stop with such a slide, and of course we will have that in the file. But let's come back to our forecast for all offices in Europe for 2018 in total return including in income return plus capital growth. The most important higher total return is expected in Germany and especially in Berlin, thanks to higher rents and lower yields, as you can guess it. In central Paris, we expect 8% total return with a better effect in Paris CBD and in La Défense at 10 and 11%, thanks to higher rents and lower yields in terms of decrease. This is the first point. In Southern Europe, especially in Milan, Barcelona and Madrid, the situation is not too bad, and even in Italy, we have recorded an 8% increase for best assets in terms of rents in Milan, and that's why we expect a double-digit total return for this year, and it's a good result compared to the past in Italy. But once we say that, we can see our expectation for 2019 for the main variable, which could be explained the total return. How we can read this? It's for 2019, the expectation for average yield, the difference in terms of average yield between end 2019 and end 2018 compared to the rental growth for the market in 2019 expectation. The situation could be challenging in London. We expect an increase in terms of average yield, not a strong increase, but anyway, an increase at more or less 15 bips. This is the first point, and a moderate decrease in rents, minus 3% only, because we have already had a decrease in terms of rental values over the past since 2016. This is the first point. Second point, we still expect a decrease in terms of average yield in Germany, as you can see, close to minus 5 and minus 10 bips. This is the first point. And second point, a new further increase in terms of rents in the German markets, especially in Berlin, with a 10% increase expected, and 5% expected in Cologne, in Hamburg, and between 5 and 10 in Frankfurt and Munich. This is the first point. We expect a leveling off in terms of average yield for most office markets in France, especially in Paris CBD, La Défense and Lyon, with a further increase in terms of rental values, close to +2, +3% in Paris CBD, La Défense and Lyon as well. This is our major forecast we can share. And it's this slide, it's our expectation in terms of vacancy rate. We have seen our expectation in terms of buildings under construction in Île-de-France especially. And you can see our expectation in terms of vacancy rate at end 2019. This is the level at the top in blue, and this is the 2019 variation, as you can say, in gray at the bottom. We expect still a decrease, but a low decrease in terms of vacancy rate in Germany, a more significant increase in London, because as you know, we have already recorded significant deliveries for the last 3 years, close to 100 million square meters per year, and the vacancy rate should begin rising in 2019. A strong increases in Paris CBD, La Défense, especially, but we don't expect a significant increase in Paris CBD. We will see our forecast for Paris CBD just after. We expect an increase, but moderate increase in La Défense because buildings under construction are relatively significant in La Défense for years to come, after a very low point in terms of vacancy, currently at 4.5%. But the situation could be not too bad in La Défense for the future, because compared to the latest crisis recorded in La Défense in 2012 and 2013, we have had difficulties concern in La Défense over the past in 2012, especially because of higher rents expected compared to the market. But currently, as you know, incentives remain high. Average headline rents are relatively moderate. That's why it should be easy to rent new buildings in La Défense, even if we expect significant deliveries for the future. So, in this slide, we can say more in detail our expectation for vacancy rate, especially and total return for Paris CBD. We expect a low point. Vacancy rate should reach a low point in 2008, a trough at 1.4%, a moderate increase expected in 2019 at only 1.8%. It's very, very low compared to the past, as you can see. That's why we expect further increase in terms of rents for the future in Paris CBD. For total return, 10% total return expected in 2018, thanks to a plus 6% capital growth expected, and still further growth in terms of capital values in 2019, especially thanks to new increase in terms of rents. Even if we expect a stabilization in terms of average yields for Paris CBD, we will have a further increase for market rental value. This explains the plus 2% in capital growth. And we have another positive news in Paris CBD. We have a strong gap between the market rental value and the current rental cash flow in Paris CBD. We have more or less 10% gap between the market rental value and the rental cash flow. That's why, as soon as you will rent an office in Paris CBD, you will have a catch-up effect, a positive growth in your cash flow, and a positive impact on the capital value. And it's thanks to that we can remain positive, moderately, but positive in terms of increasing capital values in Paris CBD, especially for 2019 and maybe for 2020 also.